Praise the Lord. So good to see you all this morning. Are you glad to be at Fellowship Church today? Praise the Lord. You can stand, sit, how you may feel, but we certainly want you to worship with us this morning. Amen.
Of our God and King, our living things will praise. From the ends of the earth, the saints will rise and sing.
They'll sing
from valley floor
to mountain high, from every distant shore. All goes out, the people rise
and sing. They'll sing and praise Him. Praise Him, let all the people praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, let all creation sing. Let all creation sing, yeah. Join us now. All creatures of our God and King, all living things will praise. From the ends of the earth, the saints will rise and sing. They'll sing and praise Him. Praise Him, let all the people praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, let all creation sing. Praise Him, praise Him, let all the people praise Him, praise Him, praise Him, let all creation sing. Worthy to receive the glory, honor belongs to You forever, our King and Lord. All praise belongs to You. Sing it now.
Worthy to receive.
Oh yeah, yeah. King and Lord, all praise belongs to You. He's worthy.
Worthy to
oh yeah, yeah.
Honor belongs to
You forever. Our King and Lord, all praise belongs to You. And praise Him, praise Him, let all the people praise Him. Sing, oh yeah. Praise Him, praise Him, let all the people praise Him. Praise Him, praise Him, let all creation sing. Let all creation sing, yeah.
Instead of pain, there's freedom though You've captured me. I've got joy instead of mourning.
There's beauty in my brokenness,
'cause I've got true love.
I've got true love instead of pain.
Of this freedom. I've got joy.
I've got joy instead of mourning.
Oh, 'cause You give me joy. soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, cause you give me joy.
Down deep in my soul,
down deep in my soul.
Have you got the joy of the Lord today?
There's nothing worth the Lord that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord,
let us become more aware of your There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Well, I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord. Sing it with me, Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. Can you feel his presence this morning? Praise the Lord. He is good. Amen. Well, now, as always, is a time of worship. It's not a separate part of worship. It's a time of worship given unto the Lord. Amen. Now, as I frequently say, God commands us to give. So my number one priority for giving is not so I can get back. But on the other hand, the Bible does say that if you give, it shall be given back to you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together. So that means that God wants me to expect to receive something back from him. That's not my main motive. It's just what you call a benefit of obeying God. Amen. Lord, we just ask this morning that the people that give, Lord, show them a blessing. Because the Bible says that if we give in due season, we will reap a harvest. Amen. So we just ask that the people that give this morning, we call a blessing upon them. Lord, in due season, they will reap a harvest. But Lord, we just count it a privilege, not an obligation, to give to you this morning. Even though you command it, and we will do it out of obedience, we call it, we don't call it an obligation, we call it a blessing. We think of it as a privilege to give unto you to the local work of God so further his kingdom. And Lord, each and every person today that gives, whether it's through online or whether they mail it in or whether they're here today to physically give it, Lord, we just ask that you bless each and every one of them as they give of their hard-earned labor, and that they will receive a blessing, a return on it, that will bless them in a mighty way. And we ask it all in the name of Jesus, and everybody says, amen. Amen. There's nothing with me north more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord, I've tasted and seen. I've tasted Be seated. Praise the Lord. How's everybody doing today? I'm going to talk today on the subject of joy, because a lot of people have let the devil, even Christians, take their joy in these days and times. But I just want to say simply, this is the title of my message, don't lose your joy. Because the Bible says that the joy of the Lord is your strength. How many of you want to go around weak? How many of you want to go around with strength in your mind, in your soul, in your spirit, in your physical body? We want to have strength and the joy of the Lord. If it says the joy of the Lord is your strength, that means if we don't have it, we're some weak people. But I want to be strong, and I know you do too. You see, all of us, every single one of us, have opportunities. I said opportunities. To get upset or to be frustrated. Someone could be mean to us, ugly to us. Anybody, you ever have anybody just be downright ugly to you? How about you get in some traffic and it makes you an hour late? Tempted to lose your joy, don't you? Simple things with myself is losing my car keys and my billfold. I don't know about you, but sometimes I'm like, where is my car keys? Where is my billfold? And my wife has to say, don't lose your joy over it. You'll find it. You'll find it. See, life, even in the little things, has its inconveniences, has its delays, has its disappointments, doesn't it? And let me tell you something. If you're like me and you're a creature of habit, it's probably going to happen again sometime. So I need to know that I'll always do find my billfold. I always do find my keys. I just got to be calm. And even in things that are worse, when somebody's really nasty to you, you know what? That still, we can still keep our joy, because we can just go on, because what they say should not affect us to the point that we just entirely lose it for the rest of the week, right? We should be able to still keep our joy. John 16:22 says, Jesus is talking here. He says, so you have sorrow now, but I will see you again and your hearts will rejoice. And no one, he says, will take your joy from you. Jesus, the Christ, the Savior, said that no one can take your joy from you if you're in Christ. In other words, no one can steal your joy. In order to lose it, you've got to give it away. So no, you know what? Don't give it away. By your attitude, by your actions, by your words, keep your joy. Well, what if you're in a traffic delay and you're an hour late? Well, is it worth giving up your joy? What if a person is rude to you at Walmart? Are you going to lose your joy? Is it worth giving them your joy the rest of the day? No. Well, that plan that you had at home to work something out, or that plan that you had at work when it fell through and didn't work, is it worth losing your joy? That negative comment that somebody said to you that's even really close to you, are you going to let that ruin the rest of your day? Well, listen, I don't believe that we should let anybody or anything steal us from what gives us strength. Steal from us what gives us strength. Listen, I don't know about you, but this day and time, it seems like that everybody is in a hurry. I can get on my car, and almost every day it seems like somebody is pushing me. The other day, I was right here close on this street, close to my house, and somebody was pushing me for everything they're worth. Well, there are three lanes. There's one in the middle. There's one over here. People, cars going this way, and I'm going this way. I said to myself, I'm just going to get in the middle lane. I got in the middle lane, they wouldn't pass me. I'm like, you mean you pushed me and now you ain't gonna pass me? And finally, I pulled back in the lane and their house was sitting right there. And they had been pushing me for 100 yards to get to their house that was right there. I thought, my goodness, Jesus, please help this world. With some people that are uptight. They got to get to some place. Have you ever had somebody push you, and they push you real hard, and you let them go on by, and you wind up like 2 minutes later, and you're right behind them at a stoplight? Doesn't do them any good. So don't you get upset about it, okay? You never know what they might do these days. My gosh. So none of us should let things that we can't control ruin our day. We need to have the attitude, I'm going to enjoy my life to the best of my ability. I can't control what others might do and say, but I can control how I respond. Amen. You have the joy of the Lord on the inside of you, and you can control how you respond. The devil will use even really good people, some of your best friends, to try to discourage you. But know that it's not them, it's the enemy trying to talk through them. Don't let it keep you from losing your joy. I mean, keep it from losing. What the hell did I just say? Don't lose your joy. Let me say that. Don't let the same people, the same inconveniences, your forgetfulness, like me, steal your joy. Life on this earth is very short. The Bible says it's but a mist or but a vapor. So it's too short to get that frustrated and upset over things that we absolutely cannot control. Now, you hear a lot about people's rights today. And people do have a right to their opinion. But I've learned another thing. You have a right to ignore what they say, too. Don't let their negative comments upset you. Because just because they say it does not mean it's true. I have found there's a lot of authorities on a lot of subjects that people don't know anything about, and they want to voice it. So don't you let it upset you. You know, if it's not in God's word, don't let it upset you. What somebody says about you, if it is negative, does not mean it's true. They may say, well, he's a bad person. No, he's a bad person only if he starts doing things that are wrong toward people. Right? If he's helping and he's doing the best he can, ignore that. Do the best you can.
Amen. We're none of us perfect, the Bible says. But as Christians, we do the best we can. I believe that. I believe most Christians live the best way we possibly can with the help of our Savior. Someone, and listen, a lot of times, if someone is doing a lot of criticizing about you, that must mean you're doing something. Something positive in this world, amen? And if they're talking about you, just remember, you're going up. Doesn't matter what they say. You're blessed by Almighty God, the creator of the universe, amen? You are blessed by Him today if you're following in His footsteps, learning of Him, walking in His steps, walking in His ways. You are a champion in Christ. Sometimes people get jealous and they try to push you down with their words. Pay them no mind. It's only a distraction from the devil. Sometimes, regretfully, even family members may not be totally for you. Sometimes it's colleagues. Sometimes it's fellow employees. Sometimes it's friends. Sometimes it's your first cousin. But it doesn't matter who they are. Just keep your joy. Don't lose your joy. Stay strong in God. Some people don't like it if you do well in anything. And the bottom line is this. Do not get involved with things or conflicts that do not elevate you to a higher level in anything. It's not worth it. Amen? Satan would love to get you off course, to get you mad, to get you offended, and then you start trying to defend yourself and convince them that you're not this and you're not that. And you don't need to defend yourself. You do the best you can, walk in love, and you make sure you're right unto God. Amen. Your obligation is to run your race, be who God called you to be, and not worry about the critics. You're not obligated to convince people to change their mind about you, to make people like you. Now listen, I want people to like me, and I'll do my best as long as I'm being myself. I want them to like me. But I'm not going to change myself totally just because of what they think. The reason I need to change is because I need to change if God thinks I need to change something, not man. Amen? Not everyone is going to like you. Not everyone is going to like me. I mean, and I just don't understand that. I mean, I'm such a nice guy, you know. I'm such a wonderful person. You know what I mean? Don't you think I'm a pretty good guy? You know, I'm nice. And I'm so graceful in everything I do. I'm wonderfully graceful. I took ballet in college. You could tell it, can't you? But you see, not everybody will. How about Joseph and his brothers? Joseph's brothers were jealous of him, extremely jealous of him. And I understand to a degree, because the daddy treated him better than the other ones. You got to treat them like my grandmother used to say, you got to treat them the same. You got to treat them the same. But you know, you do. Jacob showed favoritism toward Joseph, and it made all the brothers mad. Still didn't give them a right to do what they did. But after all that Joseph had been through, this is Genesis 50:20. It says, you intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me to this position so I could save the lives of many people. No, don't be afraid. I will continue to take care of you, talking about his brothers, and your children. So he reassured them by speaking kindly to them. So Joseph and his brothers and their families continued to live in Egypt. Joseph lived to the age of 110 years old. Why? Because of two reasons. One, he was faithful to God. He never cursed God. He never gave up on God. Even when he went to prison, when he was thrown in a pit, and all the bad things that happened to him. But second, I believe, it doesn't quite say this, but I believe he kept his joy. Because there's no way he could have gone through all of that if he would have lost his joy. Amen. He still had the joy of the Lord inside him. You see, Saul, King Saul hated David, didn't he? He was jealous of him. He said, look, it's like the thousands, they said in there, the thousands cheer for Saul, but the 10,000s cheer for David. He got jealous. He got so jealous he tried to kill him. See, but God turned it for David's good. Turned it around, and he became strong in the Lord. He kept his joy, and he eventually became king of Israel. Amen. And God blessed his life. And it was not because sometimes he was the most moral person. He made some bad mistakes. But yet the great thing about David was he admitted when he was wrong. He didn't have a pride problem. He said, yes, wrong, God, I was wrong. I am sorry. I committed sin. Now I throw myself upon the mercy seat of you. God likes it when we just throw ourselves out and say, look, yes, we've messed up, but we know that. Can you please forgive us? And he'll gladly do it. Amen. All the hatred and gossip that came their way and that comes your way is a distraction that the enemy will try to use. The devil wants you to get involved in fights and arguments that really don't help you or that don't matter. So stop being upset and losing your joy at people who aren't really for you anyway. Some people are not going to like you. I don't understand it either. You could change and do everything that they wanted and they still have a complaint. They still find a fault and then let you know all about it. But see, you don't need those people's approval to become what God wants you to be today. Matthew 5:5 says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Meek does not mean weak. It just simply means humble or strength under control. When you don't pay attention to your naysayer, so to speak, you're not being weak, but you're being meek. You have the power actually to straighten them out, but you choose not to. Because you're not going to waste your time engaging in things that won't change anyone's mind or perspective. So if we stay on the high road and we walk in love, God Almighty would take care of everybody that's not for us. See, feelings can cause you to want to get revenge on people. Feelings can cause you to want to pay back somebody. And if you let them rule you, you'll get upset and you will lose your joy. You will lose your strength. I don't know about you today, but I want to keep my strength in the Lord. How about you? And we cannot lose our joy because we lose our strength. I don't care what sport you're playing. I don't care what it is. If you lose your strength, you have lost it. Amen. But even more so in the spiritual and in your life, you've got to keep your strength in the Lord. And the joy of the Lord, the Bible says, is your strength. Psalm 94:13 says, that you may grant him power to calm himself and find peace in the days of adversity. Do you believe we're in some days of adversity? Until the pit is dug for the wicked and the ungodly. Now this verse the psalmist wrote did not promise you will not have adversity. It just says that you'll be able to stay calm and find peace in your adversity. Amen? You'll have an opportunity to get upset, frustrated, mad, distracted, but God will give you the ability to stay and remain calm. Look, next time, we just need to pause. Pause. We don't just jump into anger, jump into getting mad, or jump into something. Listen, learn, process it, pause before we have any action. Amen? We have the spirit to remain and the discipline as Christians already in us to remain calm and have self-control and not blow up and let something steal our joy. Listen, you may have grown up, possibly, and if you have, then you can change. But maybe you have. Some people have grown up in a bad situation, and they haven't had a good example of keeping their joy. The first thing that goes wrong, they blow up and get mad and lose their cool and do crazy stuff and say bad things that aren't necessary and that are hurtful. But you can, as a Christian, I don't care where you came from, God can help you today. Right where you're at, He can be your example. Boy, God can put some people around you that can be great examples, mentors that will lead you into learning how to keep your joy. Amen. How about trying a different way if you've not been exposed to something that's good? Listen, each and every day that we live is important and valuable. How many of you would agree with that? We're not just passing through time. Even though it's a short time here, we need to realize that each day is valuable. In the light of eternity, most things that upset us really don't matter. You ever gotten upset over something and you really let it ruin your day and then you found out it wasn't even true? Or you look at something, you look at another situation and you say, my gosh, that wasn't good, but they got it so much worse than I have. It changes your perspective, doesn't it? So I say, again, don't let anything or anybody steal your joy. You have the power to give it up or to keep your joy. Because remember what Jesus said? I read it at the beginning. No one can take your joy unless you give it up. Somebody may say something to you and embarrass you. Was it worth losing your joy? No. Think about it. Most of you have a really good family, somebody that loves you. You're here today because you got good enough health. You may not be perfect, but you're here. You've got at least good enough health. You're here. You're showing up today. You've got some good friends. You've got at least adequate money to get here and to live and to have a little something to eat. Oh, we got a lot to be thankful for. So don't lose your joy today. Amen. Last December, me and my family went to Baltimore. And I told my oldest son, Chandler, when he graduated, that I would take him to a professional football game. So I'm talking about from high school. So when he graduated high school, it took us the next semester at Christmas time, following his high school graduation, we went to see the Washington Redskins and the New York Giants in D.C. So, like my grandmother said, you got to treat them the same. So I told Cam, I said, Cam, when you graduate, we'll go to a professional football game as long as it's not too far. So we decided, well, let's go to, we went to see the Baltimore Ravens play the Pittsburgh Steelers. And you know, just, I said, I was so excited. I was going to go see Lamar Jackson, who I knew was going to be the MVP. Lo and behold, I bought my tickets 3 weeks before the game. And the last week of the season, they decided to sit him because they're having the playoffs. I'm like, gosh. And I'm like, you're kidding me. I bought these tickets. Now we don't even see the MVP. I said, we'll still have a good time. So we drove all the way to Baltimore. Well, we're unpacking. And the devil wanted us to lose our joy for sure. Because one of my sons, the one that I'm taking mainly this time, my second, my youngest son, Cam, Melanie said, "Cam, where are your clothes?" He said, "I thought you packed them for me." She said, "I thought you got them yourself. I told you to get them and put them in the car." So obviously, what were we stuck with? No clothes, and we're in Baltimore. So I said, "Well, might not work out. You might get set. There's going to be a couple things you're going to have to wear. You might not care to wear for a couple days, but you're going to be stuck with it." So we had to get some basic clothes. So you know what? I said, "You know, that's okay. The Lord has provided for us. We'll go to the cheapest place around here and get him enough clothes to get on." So we went to a cheap department store. We got him enough clothes to wear for the 3 days. Amen. So I didn't let it bother me. So then, the night of that same day, we go to a restaurant. I do know that this man was the worst waiter in human history. He forgot our we waited an hour, and we finally asked him, I said, "Sir," he had forgot to put the order in. Then we said, "Well," after we finally got the food, I said, "Can you give us," he said, "I'll get you a dessert on the house." I said, "Oh, a big piece of cheesecake, two of them, in fact." I said, "Well, now he's talking more my language." So two big cheesecakes from Cheesecake Factory, the best, I mean. And we didn't have to pay $9 to get one. So later on, 30 minutes later, I said, "Sir, where are cheesecakes at?" "Oh, I forgot to put it in." I thought, my goodness. So we go to have a fun trip. We have one member with no clothes. We go to a place to eat, and we can't get our food. And I thought, my goodness. So I went to I just said, "You know what? We're still going to have a good time." So the next day, we went to the game, and it rained, and it was the coldest I've ever seen in my life. My feet were burning, hurting. I had to get these warmers. Thank God my wife got them for me. But you know what? I said, "I'm here. I'm going to have a good time." I said, "I'm not going to lose my joy." I said, "Devil, you tried to ruin this thing, but I'm glad we've come, we've had a good time, we've been safe, we've enjoyed one another's company. We don't do that much to get off something like a place like that. How often are we going to do something this special?" See, what I had to do, though, is I had to erase all the negative and think of the good. See, I made a choice to do that. I decided, you know, I'm not going to let the devil steal my joy. I don't care how many things go wrong in this thing, you know? And we wound up having a good time. But the devil will try to tempt you. See, what he's trying to do, we try to get off instead of loving one another and having a good time. He wanted to create disharmony, right? Where things that we just sometimes, life happens, doesn't it? But we're still there. We're still having a good time. We're still among one another, loving one another. And we made the best of it and had a great time. Praise the Lord. So I got a question for you today. What if you had only a short time to live? Would you get mad at every little thing? Would you let every little thing frustrate you? Would you let these things take your joy? Would you? Say if you had a month to live. But in reality, we do have a small time on this earth to live when you compare it to eternity. James 4:14 says, "How do you know what your life will be like tomorrow? Your life is like the morning fog. It's here a little while, then it's gone." Those little things that your spouse does to agitate you, If you didn't have but a month away, would you let it bother you? But see, I want you to think in reality, we don't have a long time here on earth. So don't let it steal your joy. Be kind to one another, loving, tender-hearted, forgiving, as the book of Ephesians says, right? Most of all, don't let these things steal your joy. In reality, our life is short. We must live it with peace as much as we can. Some people will complain about going to work. Don't lose your joy just because your job's not perfect. Just be glad in this day that you got a job. Well, Sunday, you know, it's kind of early, and I my day off, my day to rest, and I got to go to church. No. Be glad that you can come to worship in the house of the Lord, because God has been good to you, has He not? So let's come and worship Him and be excited about it. Don't lose your joy. If you give up your joy where you are right now in life, you sure can't get to where you want to be. It's a testing ground, amen? If we let an irritable boss, an irritable neighbor, a mean cousin steal our joy, then we're not going to be going where we need to be. We have to stay steadfast and strong in the Lord. You need to have the attitude that Psalms 118:24 says, "This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it." How many of you say that with me? We will rejoice and be glad in it. Do you agree today? We need to rejoice and be glad in it. Amen? But it's our responsibility. We've got some action behind it, right? Because what's going to happen? Somebody's going to say something to you just as soon as you make that decision. Something's going to happen to delay you. Some inconvenience. You might even go off and not have your clothes, but you could still rejoice. Because at least God will provide you with some money to buy some more. Amen? Praise the Lord. See, let us, and I'm talking to us, let us today not live defeated and oppressed. Let us not let others, what others do or what they don't do, what they say or don't say, or what they have or don't have, steal our joy. I have, and I believe you do too, have a made up mind that we will rejoice in the Lord today. Praise God. See, there's some bad things that have happened to lots of different people in this world. And when you realize what they've been through, then you begin to put it in perspective. I use an example of a soldier, of soldiers that have lost maybe an arm or a leg in war, fighting for your freedom, fighting for our great country. You think of the price they paid. When you put it in perspective, we don't have a lot to lose our joy over, do we? How about some that have given even their lives? How about what Jesus went through when He went to the cross and all the suffering He did? It's almost a disgrace to God to lose our joy on a frequent basis. I know sometimes the Bible does say there's sorrow, but joy comes in the morning, right? I know sometimes it's natural to grieve and have sorrow because we're human, but don't sit there in it. We need to honor God. One way we can honor God, two ways, keeping our cool and keeping our joy. We say, God, thank you for your sacrifice today. Thank you for all you did, certainly all you went through. I'm going to keep my joy. And I talk to myself when I say that. Puts us all, it gives us perspective on what life really is. It gives us perspective on what, how many things we just don't even realize or think or give meditation to how just blessed we are today. Wow. Turn to Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17. Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 17. Says, now I'm reading from the NLT. It says, even though the fig trees have no blossoms, and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, and even though I left my clothes at where I went to go to, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. Salvation simply there means I will be joyful in the God of my deliverance. Amen. When you stay full of joy despite what comes against you, God can bring salvation or deliverance to you. So let's focus on keeping our joy. Life will send us some unwanted things, some disappointments. But that's when, like Habakkuk, we have to say, I will rejoice in the Lord. Yet I will rejoice in the Lord, he said. Because I know that if I'm faithful, he'll always come through. Amen. We got to decide on Saturday that on Sunday we're not going to lose our joy. We got to decide on Sunday that Monday we're not going to lose our joy. When we're tempted to get upset and lose our joy, we have to remind ourselves to remain calm. Am I perfect at this? No. But I strive to be. If you practice a few things, you'll enjoy, if you practice these few things, excuse me, you'll enjoy life more. You'll be free from the chains of depression, sadness, and frustration that try to hold you back. So I just want to conclude, and all I say today is don't lose your joy. Amen. You can stand with us. The joy of the Lord is our strength. It's not our joy, it's His joy. That's why the Bible says, I will rejoice in the Lord. It didn't say, I'll rejoice in my own ability, did it? It didn't say, I'll rejoice if things go well, if things go just right. No, because we just read what Habakkuk said, right? Even if things come against us, we can still keep our joy. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Let's just worship in just a second before we go. Lord, we just praise you. We just magnify your name. We just give you praise, Lord. We just honor you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. I won't take long, but does anybody want any? If you want prayer for anything, come down here. I'll keep my distance, but I'll pray for you. Anything at all. Anything at all.